Okay, so I believe we're at 48.3 on the second line. Mem Chesamid Aleph, about 13 lines from the bottom of the page. The last thing that we had learned was that if someone 48A3, I think is where we are.
I bookmarked
it at 8-1. Mine was at 98
A2. I think we did the very bottom of A2, but we could reread from the top of 48A2. But I'm pretty sure we did that, but it's not a problem to review. It's a good thing to review. Amar Rav Chista, Amar Ar Okva. Rav Chista said the name of Ar Okva. Misha Nishtata, someone who lost his sense and he can't make decisions for himself anymore, based because he doesn't have seichel anymore. Basin Yardin Lenuchasav Vizanim Mufarnasim Asishto Banav Nosa. Basin will go into his assets and give food and support his wife and his sons and his daughters Vidavarachir and something else. Amarli Ravina Ravashi, Maishna Mihaditani Mishalachlim Dina Sayam Vishtavas Mizonos, based on Yidon and Chosov, Umafarnas and Ishtav, Volos Bano Venosov, Volo Dabarachir. Ravina asked Ravashi, why is this case where someone who lost the sense and he doesn't have any seichel to make decisions, how come that's different that Basedin spends that guy's money to support his wife and sons and daughters? Why is it different than the case of a person who went on an international business trip? And in those days, they might be gone for years. They might never come back. And his wife is went to Basin and says, my husband needs to support me. He went out of town and he needs to support me. So in that case, Basin goes into his assets and they feed and support his wife, but not his sons and not his daughters. And they do not give this davaracha, this other thing either. We're going to say that davaracha is either tzedakah or perfume. And so how come if the person lost his senses, Basin supports his children also, but if a person went on a business trip, they do not support, Basin doesn't spend his own money to support his own sons and daughters. What's the difference? Amarle, Ravashi answered, V'lo shani lach ben yotz ladas, l'yotze shalo ladas. And wouldn't you understand that there's a difference between when you intentionally leave and not intentionally leave? When someone goes on a business trip, he should have made plans for someone to, well, nowadays cut checks, you know, to pay the bills. So from the fact that he left without making arrangements, or he was gone longer than I don't know about in that case, but and he didn't arrange for someone to support his kids, shows that he doesn't want to support his kids. And we'll learn in the next Mishnah what a person's obligations are for his son to support for his kids. But since he knew he was leaving and he could have made plans and he didn't, it shows that he doesn't want to support. So therefore, Basedin isn't going to spend his money to support his kids. However, when he lost his sense, something happened, and now he's not lucid to make decisions. So he didn't have a chance to show us that he didn't want to support his kids. So the Basin will continue to spend his money to support his kids when he's not in a state of mind to make decisions. Yeah, Jeff.
So he lost sense literally, or
he lost his seichel. He went crazy and he couldn't make decisions anymore. Maybe if he lost, maybe let's say someone had a stroke, he can't communicate. That would be a similar case. He's not in a mental state where he's able to make these decisions. So Basin will tap into his own assets to support his wife and his sons and his daughters.
Now it's called power of attorney.
Right. So when they didn't have power of attorney, Basin could act assuming. So when there was no power of attorney, what was the assumption? If he suddenly had this medical problem and he couldn't make a decision, Basin will say he probably wanted to support his sons and daughters. Wife, there's no doubt that he has an obligation to support her. But when he didn't lose his ability to communicate or to make decisions, and he went overseas and didn't leave any way to support his kids, then Basin is saying, well, he's showing us that he doesn't want to support his kids, so we're not going to spend his money because it doesn't look like it's the way he wanted to spend his money. Maybe they should nominate him for Father of the Year. My davar acher, what is this other thing that he that they either do a pay for or not pay for? Rav Chista amar ze tachshit. Rav Chista says it's a tachshit, which Rashi explains is perfume. Rav Yosef amar tzedakah. Rav Yosef says it's tzedakah. Man amar tachshit. Rav Chista, who said that it's the a perfume, kol shekein tzedakah. So if so when the husband goes goes across the sea and they don't buy, so the based in, excuse me, the Brisa says, oh, that they don't buy, they so if to support his wife but they don't support his kids and don't buy her perfume, kol shekein tzedakah, they certainly wouldn't pay tzedakah out of his, they wouldn't take tzedakah out of his assets. But man damer tzedakah, the opinion who says that davar acher is tzedakah, so if he went on a business trip internationally, so Beis Din does not take tzedakah, aval tashi yavinan la. But that opinion would hold that the perfume, they would support her with, delo nichalei disnavel, because he doesn't want her to become disgusting by not having this perfume. So Beis Din will tap into his assets and give tzedakah in his name. So for this tzedakah, it's a good question. This tzedakah probably means the communal tzedakah that they levied people in the community based on what they could pay. Remember, there was a tzedakah that they would collect every week to feed the poor people in the city and to clothe the poor people in the city. And then there was the tzedakah that they would take every day from what people had cooked for the day, and they'd give that to transient people who had come into town. So meaning, because his family lives in the town, he would still have to pay his share of tzedakah for the poor people of the town. They're not going to make a donation in his name. You know, they're not going to sponsor volume 74 of the Art Scroll, you know, whatever, in his name, but it's talking about the communal thing that people in the city have to pay for the poor people in their city. But obviously, that type of tzedakah, everyone's assessed by the gabayim based on what they could afford. So they wouldn't be, you know, bleeding him dry by taking this tzedakah out of his assets. Turn to 48A3. Rav Chiya bar Avin, Amar Rav Huna. Rav Chiya bar Avin said, in the name of Rav Huna, Mishalach Limdina Sayam Umesa Ishto, someone who went overseas and his wife died, based in Yarden Lanachasa Vekovrno Solafi Chavodo. Beis Din goes into his assets and they bury her according to his honor. So, meaning our Mishnah did say that when he dies, he has to pay for her funeral expenses, including the lamenters and the flutes that to get people to cry. So from this brisa, so he's not there, so Beis Din will take his assets and pay for her funeral. So the question is that the word says v'kovrno so lefi chavodo, they will bury her according to his honor. So the Gemara says lefi chavodo v'lo lefi chavoda, according to his honor and not according to her honor. Maybe she's from a more important family and they would do more expensive stuff for burial. Ema af lefi chavodo. So it must mean that his statement was even according to his kavod, meaning, let's say she was from a more simple family and they did not do an elaborate funeral. He was from a more sophisticated family and they spent more on funerals. You might think that he would only have to bury her according to what her family's custom is. So Rav Chiya bar Avin is saying the name of Rav Huna, no, the Beis Din would take out of his assets, even though he's not here to okay it, Beis Din would take out the higher amount to give her a funeral commensurate with his family's ways of doing a funeral. Hakamash Malan, and this is teaching us, Ola ima ve'ena yoredes ima v'filo l'achar misa. She will be elevated to his, with him, to his status, ve'eno yoredes ima, and she doesn't go down to his status if she's from an originally higher status, afilo l'achar misa, even after she dies. So meaning, because she was married to him, she is now, his family had this higher more expensive way of doing things. Even though she died now and she's not with him anymore, literally because she's not alive anymore, we still, the elevation that she underwent by marrying him, she stays in that higher level that you would get the more expensive funeral. Now, one thing here, and there's a Gemara in Gittin that it used to be that it was not good. People would spend a lot of money on funerals. Lahavdil, you know, about 30 years ago was getting it to be a problem with weddings. And then a bunch of Rabbanim made this takana, and then none of them kept the takana, so they undid the takana about you could only invite up to so many people. It's been up to this much people and have a one-man band and this and that. That's been it was a joke at the time, and it's doesn't exist anymore. But there was things like that were going on for funerals and fancy clothes and this and that until I think Rabbi Gamliel, one of the Nisim, asking that everyone gets buried in the same type of tachrichim because it was causing a lot of trouble and people were wasting money, and there were these, you know, stupid fights about people trying to outdo each other for fancier funerals. So I don't know if this, if I don't remember, I don't know the limits of Rabbi Gamliel's takana, if it was Rabbi Gamliel, or if it was only about the tachrichim itself or about other things. And how this particular halacha here is in accordance with Rabbi Gamliel Takana. Rabbi Gamliel Takana was later. Probably Rabbi Gamliel was a Tana, and this is Amoraim. So this is probably, even after his Takana, there were still certain things, more expensive ways of doing a funeral. Amar of Masna, Rav Masna says, Ha'omer imesa losik beruha minachasav. So if someone said, if his wife dies, don't spend money from his assets on her funeral. So meaning this is talking about a person who's on his deathbed. And there's a halacha that normally if someone would say something, you know, just because he says something doesn't make it true. But when someone is on their deathbed and they say something, it has extra, the words that we believe him more. So if he was on his deathbed, so what's going to happen? Because he's dying first, his wife is going to be, he's not going to be alive anymore. So when the Gemara that we've been talking about last week and this week was saying that the husband pays for his wife's funeral, that's when she dies first, and because he doesn't have to pay for the ksuva, but so he pays some of the money that he would have had to pay to support her for a funeral. But if he dies first, his heirs, his sons, would have to keep paying from his estate to support her because that's what the ksuva is. Now, what about the funeral? So if a person said that he doesn't want his estate to pay for her funeral, shomenlo, we listen to him. So Rashi says, since he dies first and she will collect the ksuva, he doesn't have to pay to bury her, as we're going to learn in a Mishnah later on, that her heirs, who will inherit her ksuva, they have to bury her. And when does the husband bury her? When he didn't have to pay out the ksuva. So the Gemara asks, Maishna kiyamar denafli nechse kame yasmi. So why did he say this, that he didn't want to pay for the funeral? Denafli nechse kame yasmi. Because his property, his estates, is going to go to his orphans, meaning his sons. And in this case, these his minor children, or maybe they're not necessarily minors, they're his biological children, but they're not his wife's biological children. So ki lo amar nami nichse kame yasmi ramu. So if so, even if he didn't say anything, we should also say that his estate is going to the orphan. So why is this not the default halacha? Why is it only halacha if he said it? Ella, so Rav Masna couldn't have said what we thought he said. Ella ha'omer imeis hu lo tikberu minachasav. So it must have been that he said, if he dies, but meaning he's talking about himself in the third person, don't bury him from his property. Ain't Shomelo, we don't listen to him. Lav Kalimeno Shiasher is Banav, Bia Palatzmelo Tzibor. It's not his right that he should enrich his sons and put himself on the community, that the community would have to pay out of tzedakah funds to bury him. So meaning it's talking about if he's saying, I don't want my kids to pay for my own funeral, we don't listen. Because if they don't pay for the funeral, the community is going to have to pay for the funeral. And so we're saying that he's just trying to keep a tax evasion over here in his estate planning, so we don't listen to him. And in the Kesser Marav bylaws from like 1934, whatever it was, there's a thing that they would pay up to whatever, $5 to have a carriage to take the remains of a member to the cemetery. So it's something that was in the bylaws. And my impression is from when I went to England, the Chevra Kaddish and stuff was more as in England, even nowadays, or this was 14 years ago, 15 years ago, whatever, about people would have to be a member of a shul for the Chevra Kaddish to deal with things. So, I mean, obviously, I would think in those cases, but you know, people would, but you know, nowadays also there's the was it the Gomley Fund that for sometimes they have to buy plots for people who don't have plots, and obviously, you know, to bury people who don't have money to be buried, that's one of the purposes of the one of the obligations of a community's tzedakah. Is there a question?
Yeah. So. All this Mishnah anymore in assumption that there's one wife?
It's probably one wife because let's put it this way. Let's say that he was married and he had kids, and let's say his wife died. Maybe she died in childbirth, which wasn't an unusual thing. So he married someone else, and then he died a few years later. So it's possible that he could have had, right, in the time of the Gemara, he could have had multiple wives at the same time. But if he was still married, if he was married to multiple wives, his obligation of the ksuva would go to all of them. So when this Gemara that we said here, that he didn't want his, he wanted the money to go to his kids and they shouldn't have to pay for her and she wasn't their biological mother, that's obviously a case where he's no longer married to their biological mother. Or maybe he is, but this was a different wife. I guess it's possible to say that. Again, the question is, how, even when before the Cherem of Rabbeinu Gershom, which was about 1,000 years ago, when people were allowed to marry more than one wife, how common was it? Some people think it was common, and some people think it wasn't so common.
Since you brought it up, I thought, first of all, that for many years, Jews certainly didn't own land, didn't own cemeteries. But I thought even more recently, they were not supposed to. And that's why...
Supposed to what?
Own cemeteries.
What do you mean? There had to be a cemetery.
But I thought they weren't supposed to own them, the land. And so there was a legal fiction... always with not always, but until more recently, where if you notice, there's a non-Jewish cemetery next to all the old Jewish cemeteries. And like with Shalom, it was set up not as Shalom. It was set up under the non-Jewish name, Randy.
Rand Hill.
And the same with Waldheim originally, and but it changed more recently.
I'm not aware of that. I mean, there's explicit Gemara that the Beis Din had to have their own cemetery, that the people who were killed by Beis Din were buried in the Beis Din cemetery. So obviously the community had to own that. The Gemara's in Megillah talks about this, about selling a shul, selling a cemetery, you know, things like that. So I'm not aware, though. I don't know everything, but okay. I'm not aware of this thing where they didn't own cemeteries.
Okay. Because, and also like in Chicago, it wasn't the cemeteries themselves that provided the tzedakah. It was the Jewish funeral homes that traditionally did.
Right, and that's and still true.
I happen to know that, you know, right. Weinstein and Peisers paid for funerals for
right.
people.
Right, that's true. But but the thing is that in the time of the Gemara, if you learn the first Perek of Bava Basra and learn about tzedakah and about other levies that the community would levy to food for people, clothes for people, things like that. So one of the needs of the community would also be, you know, would be to bury people. I don't think the Gemara there explicitly mentions, but it's understood. We do understand the idea more than almost anyone else. Jews came to a city. What did Jews build? A hospital. Jews also for Bikur Cholim. I mean, well, not just Bikur, but Refuah, to heal people. So in the time where the communities were able to tax and had the authority to collect on those taxes, the community itself would pay for the funerals. But like you said, nowadays here, it does seem that it's the funeral homes themselves who raise money or pay for funeral of people who have no money to be buried otherwise. But really, things like that's not that different from a meis mitzvah, right? If someone dies, they're like a meis mitzvah.
Yeah.
But the way that the community set it up is, and this is brought down in I guess commentators on Shulchan Aruch, whatever, that nowadays, if we hear someone dies, or it's because there is a chaver kedisha and stuff, they're the ones who will take care of the mace. So it's not as there's not so much as the status of a mace mitzvah as there used to be, but still there are some people who no one takes care of except one person. When that person, if that person would pass away, the person who is taking care of them is basically taking care of a mace mitzvah. I mean, obviously they call the funeral home and call the chaver kedisha, but they're still the ones who make the arrangements. And I'll just say from personal experience, when my wife's uncle died, 6 months into COVID, and it was not full lockdown at the time, but, you know, I was in charge of getting the body to Eretz Yisrael. It happened to be that Chana's other uncle had a plot for him, but still to get him from Chicago to Eretz Yisrael. Once you get to Eretz Yisrael, her cousins took care of it, but I had to get him to Eretz Yisrael. And it was such a, when Rav Yasha Ber says in the Out of the Whirlwind and other things about when the state of being an onain before between the death and burial, you can't concentrate on anything because you love the confrontation, the encounter with death. You know, we weren't allowed in the nursing home or this or that, but for us to get him to on a plane to Eretz Yisrael, it was so nerve wracking, couldn't do anything, and we were so lucky that the flight direct from here from Chicago to Israel was still going on then, and he died at 9 or 8 a.m. and he was on the 6:30 whatever p.m. flight, and he was buried in Israel about 24 hours after he died in Chicago. That everything worked out so well from that perspective, but still for me to be in charge to you know, it's a strange feeling.
It's not good because you'd think in Chicago that things would be.
In Chicago, it's even worse because the cemeteries will say, oh, we're busy that day. We're not going to open up a grave. For Mr. Goodman, he was in a section where they don't have their own equipment. They borrow the equipment from a neighboring cemetery. And when, you know, the people gathered there to go, they had already put the body in the grave and covered it because they wanted to bring the equipment back to their time. And it was before the time that they'd announced for the funeral. I mean, so, you know, there are better funeral homes and there's worse funeral homes. But the cemeteries themselves are some of the biggest problems. Years ago, well, in the late 90s, it was, someone died on Chol Hamoed Pesach, and they called a certain funeral home, which shall remain unnamed. And they said the first funeral we'll have is, I think it was like on a Friday, and then it was Shabbos, and then I think the last days of Yom Tov was Sunday night, so Monday and Tuesday. So she died on Friday, and they said, oh, we'll do it on Tuesday, because they did on second day of Yom Tov. They didn't care. But they knew that Rabbi Lazowski wouldn't do it. So they'll say, you know, and I don't even know if they're going to let them do it the next day, because if they were, So they didn't want the you know, they weren't from, but they knew that the from practice was not to wait that long to bury, and Sunday was Easter. So they like the few days. So the funeral home says the cemetery is closed and they're not going to do it. So my father called up the head groundskeeper and said, you know, this is what they're saying. I don't think they're telling me the truth. They're like, you're right. It's Easter. So we'll charge you double time. But yeah, we'll do it. And the funeral director was super mad because they didn't want to do the funeral on Sunday. But we got the funeral done on Sunday. So in that case, the cemetery was better than the funeral director. But a lot of times now in Chicago, the problem is the funeral is the cemetery not being able to open the grave. And then there are other things. Before my time, there used to be gravediggers strikes.
Right.
And then people wouldn't be able to be buried for weeks. They were union. Yeah.
Always in Chicago.
Right. And in New York also. So there's a book, an article book, Lieutenant Berenbaum. Once someone must gave Rivarn the book, because there was a share once I heard, and he was talking about stories from this book. So isn't it the guy, basically he was an officer. I think he was a first lieutenant, so not a highest rank, but pretty low. But he was in World War II, at the end of World War II in Europe. And so he was an American officer who was meeting a lot of Holocaust survivors right after the war was over, or as the war was ending, and it's an interesting thing. His father wasn't from, his mother was from, so he was from, and interesting stories in the book. And one of the things he mentioned was during the end of the cemetery strikes, people were trying to dig their own grave, but it was in the middle of the winter and the ground was frozen solid. So he said how he brought sandwiches and coffee for the grave diggers and was schmoozing them up. And, you know, so he said, you know, how do you dig the graves when it's cold like this? He says, oh, it's easy. You put twigs and stuff and you light a fire on top. It melts the top and then you can dig it real easy. So that he found the secret. And then he was able to tell people, so they were able to bury some of the people who had been, unfortunately, literally piling up when they couldn't be buried because the grave diggers were on strike. This was probably in the 60s.
My father passed away long ago on Chalamoid Place.
But okay.
93.
Right. I mean, do I want to know? Well, what was it? I mean, was the official Soviet thing probably not to bury people? They probably were into cremation.
No. We knew that then.
No, but I'm saying the communist people who weren't Jewish, did they bury in cemeteries?
Yeah.
Or did they cremate?
Well, the time I was there, it some
people. Right, when you were there. But if, let's say, someone Jewish died, they'd go to a funeral, and I mean, they'd go to a cemetery, dig a grave, and bury the person, right?
That's also, I was in funerals of different people. Some of them were cremated, some of them were not buried.
Right.
All of them were Jewish.
Right, no, I understand, but okay. But there wasn't, was there bureaucracy involved? I mean, here, I mean, it's not necessarily government bureaucracy, but dealing with the cemeteries to open up a grave. I mean, would people, relatives and stuff, dig themselves?
The former Soviet Union, because they had like one or two cemeteries for city, like 2 million people.
Right, okay.
Go do something.
Okay, Mishnah at the bottom of Mem Ches Amud Aleph 48a3. So Liolam hi bershus ha'av at shetekanes rishus habal lenesuin. She always stays in under her father's rishus, and they translate as domain. There's not exactly a good. She basically her father has to give her permission for certain things. Her father is her boss for certain things until she enters to the permission or the domain of her husband for Nisuin. So once entering her husband's domain for Nisuin, which we would classify as chuppah under most terms, that's when she is no longer under the control of her father. Masra avlishluchei habal, if her father gave her to the agents of the Baal, of the husband's agents, to bring her to the husband, Hareyu Rishus HaBaal. Then she's considered also that she's entered the Rishus of the Baal, even though she didn't actually have chuppah yet. Halacha av im shluchei HaBaal, if the father himself went with the agents of the husband, o shahalchu shluchei av im shluchei HaBaal, or the husband sent agents together with the husband's agents, Hareyu Rishus HaAb. She stays in her husband's, under her father's control, because since her father is there, or her father agents are here, the act of her being given over to their husband, it hasn't been completed yet. Masru shluchei av l'shluchei HaBaal, Hareyu Rishus HaBaal. If the father's agents gave the, her over to the husband's agents, then she becomes into the domain of her husband. Meaning, let's say her husband, you know, her husband was in city A, and excuse me, her father is in city A, and the husband is in city B. So for the wedding, they have to go from A to B. And for whatever reason, the father didn't go with, but he sent people to bring her. So if they were meeting in the middle somewhere, so his people brought her to a certain place, and then in this middle place, you know, the husband's people picked her up. So then she's considered no longer in her father's domain authority when the father's agents send her over to that aid. Now, just thinking, in modern Hebrew, I think Rishus Adar in Hebrew, in Israel, means the postal authority. So maybe the word Rishus here would also make more sense to say under the father's authority versus the husband's authority. That might be a better translation than this. But I mean, Rishus could be property, Rishus HaRab and Rishus HaYachid, public domain, private domain. Rishus could be permission. But I think authority and domain, so I think authority would make more sense as a word than domain would in this case. Okay, so the Gemara says, "My la'olam." How come the first word in the Mishnah is la'olam? She's always in the father's authority until she enters to the husband's authority for nisuin. La'afuka mi'mishnah rishona, to exclude from the earlier Mishnah that nana we learned at the very beginning of Ksuvos. Higiyas man v'lo niso achals mishalav achals b'truma. So it used to be that the nisuin, the chuppah, had to be within a year of the erusin. So what happened if the 12 month happened and he did not do nisuin to her? So ochlus mishalo, he has to pay for her food. And if she's a kohen, she's allowed to eat truma, even though she didn't have nisuin yet. Kamash malan liolam. So this Mishnah is arguing on that Mishnah and saying, no, even if the year passed, but if he didn't do nisuin yet, she's still under the authority of the father, and the father has, and the husband doesn't have to support her yet. And if she's a kohen, he's a kohen, she's not allowed to eat truma yet until they do the nisuin process. Two dots. Matzar av l'shulchei HaBaal harei b'shus HaBaal. So the Mishnah said if the father gave her to the agents of the husband, then she is considered in under the authority of the husband. Amarav mesiraso l'chol chutz mitruma. So Rav says this being given over makes her under the husband's domain. That's for everything except for truma. Rav Asi Amar, but Rav Asi says afla truma, as we turn to 48b2, even for truma, she is considered his wife, even though chuppah hasn't happened yet. Esavei Rav Huna Rav Asi v'amri l'Rav Chiya bar Rav l'Rav Asi. So there's a question, either Rav Huna or Rav Chiya bar Rav asked Rav Asi. Rav Asi's opinion is she is fully his wife, and she's even allowed to eat truma if he's a kohen. As soon as the father gives her over to the husband's agent. Li'olam hiber shusa avachit kanes l'chuppah. The Mishnah says that she's always under the authority of the father until there's chuppah. And this isn't chuppah. Just giving her over to the agents isn't chuppah. So Amar Luhu Rav. Rav said to them, Lava mina luhu, didn't I tell you? Lo tizu basar ibcha. Don't do something that can be explained in the opposite way. So Rashi says, don't try to answer something the base medrash from a Mishnah that can be turned from two opposite sides, that someone's able to that from a Mishnah that's ambiguous enough that anyone can twist the words of the Mishnah to support his assertion. I'm not saying twist in a bad way, but that's what it's saying. Yachal ishnu lecha. I could answer you, Misiraso zuhi kenisas lechuppah, that when it says give her over, that means giving her over to the chuppah. So therefore, when the Mishnah says that she's not in the husband's domain of authority until chuppah, this Misira could mean chuppah. Ushmuel Amar, Shmuel says Lirushasa, that being given over to the agents of the husband makes her his wife in regard to Yerusha, that he, if she would die, he would inherit stuff that was that she owned. Reish Lakish Amar Luksuvasa. And Reish Lakish says they become she comes under his authority for Ksuva. And the Gemara is gonna say what this means. So Ksuvasa Maihi. So what I just said, the Gemara is going to say what it means. That's was Rashi. But literally the next line is Ksuvasa Maihi. What does it mean that when the father gives her over to the agents of the husband, he becomes his wife for Ksuva? What does that mean? The Imesa Yarisla? If it means that if she dies, the husband inherits her, Hainu Shmuel, Hainu de Shmuel, that's the same opinion as Shmuel. So what? In what way is Ksuva, is she becoming his wife for Ksuva, according to Reish Lakish? Ravina Lomer Ksuvasa me acher mane. It means that if the husband would die, the opposite of Shmuel. Shmuel was saying, what would happen if she would die? So Shmuel says the husband would inherit her. And Reish Lakish is saying if the husband would die before the actual chuppah, and then when she would get remarried, she's considered married in regard to her next Ksuva. So when she would get remarried, she would be considered a widow and have 100 shekel ksuva, even though the chuppah never actually took place for the first wedding. Rav Yochanan and Rav Chanina da'ami trevayhu. Rav Yochanan and Rav Chanina both said, "Misirasu l'kol af l'truma." She is given over for everything, even for truma. So isn't this the same as? So this, to me, seems to be the same as Rav Asi. Oh, yeah, the article says that in the note. So Rav Asi was the very first opinion. That was the very first, the second and third word on this page. And this is the last word on the page if we go to 48b3. So Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Chanina says that she's fully his wife, even she's allowed to eat truma. Now, there's a rabbinic thing. I think we discussed it, but I might be confusing it with Gemara and Kedushin. Is that even if Midiraisa, she's allowed to eat truma because she's considered his wife, she's not allowed to eat truma until she's in the father's house, into her husband's house. Because we're worried that if she's eating truma, she might give some to her siblings, and they're not Kohanim, and if they would eat truma, it's a death penalty, a heavenly death penalty. So in order to make sure that that doesn't happen, they didn't allow her to marry truma until she's out of her husband's, out of her father's house completely. So if, I think the Gemara Kedushin mentions, so if there's a certain nafkamina between two opinions is if she was in between her father's house and her husband's house, so she's left her father's house. So are we worried? So there aren't, she doesn't have siblings with her that she might, non-Kohanim, that she would share the truma with. So that wouldn't be a worry. But if she's not yet in the husband's house, so maybe you wouldn't trumas, but there's a special rabbinic thing about that she's not allowed to eat truma until the chuppah actually takes place. But I think Midiraisa, from the time of the Arison, she Meikaradin is allowed to eat truma. Meisave, so we'll ask a question on Rabbi Yochanan's opinion. These opinions that they're married even for truma. Halacha av im shluchi habal o shahochu shluchi av im shluchi habal o shahitzel lachatzer baderech v'nichnaso imo lalin. So this is a different case. This brisa says, so if the father went with the husband's agents, or the husband sent the father's agents went with the husband's agents, o shahitzel lachatzer baderech, or she owned a courtyard or meaning a house or something on the way between her father's house and her husband's house. V'nichnasa ima lalin, and she went with her husband to sleep there. So the meaning, like, instead of having to buy a hotel for the night, she owned a house, so the people slept and stayed over in the house, but they were not going, they didn't enter the house as an act of chuppah. It was just, you know, instead of Motel 6, we're in Motel Kala. Right, Airbnb. Afa pishik suvasa beveis baila, even though the ksuva is in her husband's house. So,
parlance, that's called a tefillin night.
I'm not sure about that because we're saying that the other shluchim, the other agents, are there too.
Oh.
Because actually, the beginning of the braisa didn't even say the husband was there. It said the agents of the baal. But here it clearly means it's including the baal also. But there, I don't know if it would, if it would, only the baal would go, if that would, with her. Because it's the first line doesn't exactly, it makes it sound like it's a different case, that the baal isn't even there. Because if the baal is there, why do you need the shluchei baal? So even though the ksuva is already in her husband's house, so Rashi says that means that in her ksuva she was given, you know, what do we call it, her trousseau or whatever, you know, nowadays stuff from a shower, that there'd be sheets and blankets and towels and the dishes, stuff like that. So that stuff has already been sent ahead to the father's house, excuse me, to the husband's house. Mesa avia yorshev, she would die before the actual chuppah, her father would inherit her, but masra av l'shluchei habal. So meaning in those cases, the wedding, the nesuin isn't considered to have taken place yet. Masra av l'shluchei habal, or shemasra shluchei av l'shluchei habal. If the father gave her to the agents of the husband, or the agents of the father gave her to the agents of the husband to take her to the husband's house, oh, okay. So Marty, it's three different cases. The first case is if the father went with the husband's agents. So because the father's there, it's not, the chuppah is not considered to have taken place yet. The second case, or the father sent people with the husband's people. So because the father's people are still there, it's not a complete transference yet. So I guess the husband was bringing her, and they stayed at her property on the way. And let's say there's no yichud problems, whatever the situation was. So in any of those three cases, because they only stayed there instead of having a hotel, it was not to be considered their chuppah. So in all those cases, she's not married yet until the actual chuppah takes place. There's the second part of the Mishnah. Masr avlu shluchei abal, if the father gave her over to the agents of the baal, osha masr shluchei avlu shluchei abal, or the father's agents gave her to the agents of the husband, osha haisa lo chatzar baderech, or he had a property on the way, v'nichnasa imo l'shem nesuin, and they both went into his house as an act of chuppah, af al pi shekzuvas beveis avia, even though her trousseau, whatever the we call it, am I using the right word? All the stuff from the ksuva is still in her father's house. It's not at the husband's house yet. Mesa baila yarsha. If she died, the husband inherits her. That the act of the father giving her over, or them going into his house, l'shem chuppah, that's considered as if the chuppah took place. B'medvar memoriam, when is this true? L'irushasa. This braisa only said that they're considered married in regard to whether the husband inherits her or the father would still inherit her. But in regard to her being allowed to eat truma, she's not allowed to eat truma until she actually has chuppah. So this doesn't say that she's married for everything. It says it's only married for Yerusha. So this would be against Rabbi Yochanan and Rav's opinion that she's even allowed to eat truma. That's the question. So tiyufta dekula tiyufta. So this is, this does disprove Rav's opinion and Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Hanina, who also agreed with Rabbi Yochanan, who said that they're married even with regard to Yitruma. This Braisa shows that they're only married in regard to him inheriting, who would inherit her if she dies. So it also seems to it seems that it's also disproving Rabbi Yochanan, Reish Lakish. Reish Lakish is one who had a very different pshat. Reish Lakish's pshat with Luxuva, we said that if the husband would die, then if she gets remarried, she would only have a ksuva of an almana of 100 shekel, even though she never had chuppah. So when it says tiyufta de kulhu, it seems to, so I mean, Rashi does say everyone who argues on Shmuel, and that would include Reish Lakish. So it's not just the ones who say they're married even for truma, but it also is a refutation to Reish Lakish. Hagu fakasha. But if we look at the braisa, there's actually an internal contradiction. Amarta nichnasa ima lalin, taima lalin, hastama l'shem nesuin. In the first case of the braisa, which was when the husband and the wife went into her property and they only went there to stay overnight in place of spending money on an Airbnb, as Jeff said. I said Motel 6, but you know he's more up to date with the times than I am, and he said Airbnb. So because they went only to use it as a Airbnb, that's why it's not considered chuppah. But if they would have had a neutral kavana, not for the sake of just using it as a hotel, it sounds like it would have been considered that they're married. Ema seifa, but in the second case, the nichnasa ima l'shem nesuin, when she was with the husband and they went into the husband's house and it was l'shem nesuin, implies that the only reason they're married is because they went in with the intent that this would be their chuppah. But if they would go on with neutral intent, it wouldn't be their chuppah. So the first half of the braisa, the implication contradicts the implication of the second half of the braisa. Hustam alalin. But to say if they wouldn't have had explicit kavana for chuppah, it was just neutral kavana, then it would just be considered, oh, they're just using it as an Airbnb that night, and it's not a chuppah. So which is it? Rav Ashi says, stami k'tani. Both the first and the second half are talking about neutral cases. Stam chatzur dida lala. So if it's her house, her property, they're going in neutral cases, they're going into her place just to stay, not to live. Chuppah is when she is entering his house to live. But if they're going into her place, the default is that they're going just to stay, not to live as a husband and wife. Stam chatzur dida l'nisuin. But in general, if they'd go into a husband's property, that would be considered nesuin. Hana, we learned in a braisa, Masra av l'shluchei habal, if the father gave her over to the agents of the husband, and now we, on Memches 48b4, they're about 10 lines up from the bottom, vizinsa, and then she committed adultery, harezu b'chanek. She gets strangulation death. Because we learned for several weeks that if she was a Nara and she was Ma'orasa, she had Erisin but didn't have Chuppah yet, she gets Skila. So this Braisa says that if she committed adultery, even though the Chuppah didn't happen yet, but the father gave her over to the agents of the Baal, she's considered married enough that she's no longer an Amarasa. She doesn't get Skila, which is a stricter death penalty. She only gets Chenek. Minahani Mili, what's the source for that Braisa? Rav Ami Bar Chama has an interesting drasha. Amar kral lizno space avia, prat lehemasar ha'av l'shluchi abal. So the pasuk, when it's talking about that a nara marasa gets skila, she gets skila because she committed adultery in the house of her father. Prat shemasar av l'shluchi abal. So that would exclude a case where the father already gave her over to the agents of the husband. That's not considered being in the house of her father anymore. Ve'ema prat shenichnas l'chup av lo nevala. So Gemara says, how come you, Rabbi Ami Bar Chama, are excluding a case where the father gave her over to the husband's agent? Maybe it's excluding a case where they actually had chuppah yet, but the marriage wasn't consummated yet. Because the part of the psukim of Nara Marasa seems to be that she was still a virgin. So maybe even after chuppah, but before the marriage was consummated, I would think she gets skila. So we need this drasha to say that in such a case, she doesn't get skila. She only gets chenek, like a regular case of a married woman who commits adultery. Amarava, Rava says, Amar li Ami. Ami told me, I guess Ami was an Amora. I don't know if it's the same as Amar Rabbi Ami, because the Bryce was quoting the name of Rabbi Ami, but Rav, who was, you know, the Chacham in the time, he could call Ami by his first name. He didn't have to call him Rabbi Ami. So I'm assuming that it's the same Ami here. Chuppa behejik siva. If she had chuppa that's explicitly mentioned in the pasuk that she no longer gets skila, because the pasuk says, kiya nara besula ma'orasa le'ish, when a maiden, nara, besula, is engaged, betrothed to a man, nara v'lo bogeres, so only if she's a nara, not if she's a bogeres, that it's already more than 6 months after her physical maturity started, besula v'lo be'ula, a virgin and not someone who is not a virgin, and ma'orasa v'lo nesua, only someone who is engaged but didn't have nesuin yet. So if she had chuppah, that's already excluded in this pasuk, so therefore we wouldn't need Lizno Space Avia to teach us that if the chuppah happened but she's still a virgin because the marriage wasn't consummated, she doesn't have a death penalty. That's already, we already know in such a case she wouldn't get skila death penalty because of ma'oras of lo nesua. So my nesua, and so when it says that betrothed but not nesuin, what does nesuin mean? Elam and nesuin mamish, it means literally that she had the chuppah process. Hainu besula v'lo ba'ula. That's the same case as a virgin and not someone who's not a virgin. Alav shenichnas olachupav lo nivala. So therefore, besula, virgin and not a ba'ula, a non-virgin, it means a case where the marriage was already consummated. So then when we have another drasha that says a betrothed but not married, it must mean that the chup already happened, but the marriage was not consummated. So then from the other pasuk that Rabbi Ami says, Liz no space avia, that you only get skila if she's committing adultery in the house of her father, that would exclude the case of even before chuppah, when the father gave her over to the agents of the husband. So now as we turn to Mem Pesamet Aleph, the Ema Hecha de Hajjal of Einasha, Hajjal Milsa Kamaisa, maybe if she would return to her father's house, she goes back to the first din. So this seems to be not a question about the this particular thing. We ended the thing about the death penalty. But the Mishnah said that she always remains in her father's house until he gives her over to the agents of the husband. So what if maybe, let's say, if she would get divorced or widowed, maybe she goes back to being under her father's authority. So Amar Rava, Rava says, "Hahu kvar paska tana dvei Rabbi Shmuel." That was already decided from from a brisa from the yeshiva of Rabbi Shmuel, the tana dvei Rabbi Shmuel, because we had a brisa from the yeshiva of Rabbi Shmuel. V'neder amano grusha kol asher asa nafsho yikum aleha. The vow of a widow or a divorcee, anything that she forbids on herself stands. So meaning we mentioned a few weeks ago, maybe it was last week, maybe it was a week before, that there's laws that if a woman makes a vow, if a girl makes a vow, her father could annul it when he hears it. If it's a married woman, when her husband finds out about it, he has a day to annul the vow. And we mentioned that if she's engaged, the father still has the authority up until a certain point. So because the pasuk says that if she's divorced or widowed, whatever she says stands. She doesn't have a veto power of her father or her husband because she's not married, or she's either because she's widowed or she's divorced. So ma tamalomar, why does the Torah have to tell us that anything that she vowed stays? V'halo mutzus miklal av mutzus miklal ba'al. Because she already was married, she's no longer in her father's house, and because she's divorced or widowed, she's not in her husband's house either. So of course, anything that she makes an oath about is going to stand, and there's not going to be anyone to annul or nullify. Well, annul and nullify is the same root. Veto her vow. Ella. So what must the pasuk be talking about? That the father gave her over to the husband's agents, or her father's agents gave her to the husband's agents, and she became widowed or divorced on the way before she actually got to her husband's house. So heichani korila, what do I consider her? What status does she have? Beisavia shalzu, is she considered her father's house? Obeis baila shalzu, or is it the husband's house? Elomer lacha kevin shetsa sha achas mishusa av shuv eniyachal hafer. So this pasuk is telling us that once she, for even one moment, left her father's house, and for the marriage to be finalized, even if the marriage ended up not being finalized, she does not go back to her father's house in at least in regard to nedarim. So she doesn't go back to her father's house. We'll leave it here. We're not that far from the Mishnah, but I think we'll leave it here, and we'll at the top of 49a2 for next time to finish off a few lines of Gemara. And then the next Mishnah. So next week.